Hello, I'm Ben Magowitz. Welcome to TCM. Look who's here.
Oh, my Lord.
Tom Hanks. Tom, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Tom has a new novel out, your first novel, The Making of Another Major Motion Picture Masterpiece, which I adored. This is really taking all your experiences over the years in making movies and changing a bunch of names.
Every good thing that happened in there, I witnessed. Every knothead thing that happens in there, I am guilty of.
Yes, right.
So if somebody says something stupid, that's what I did. If someone does something great, that's what I saw.
So what inspired you to write this book? I sense that it's clear that there was a lifelong love of motion pictures.
I had never read a book that captured the movie making experience as I experienced making a movie. It's all about these human details, these odd little and very recognizable human moments that are about any great endeavor being accomplished by a huge team of people who must work together in order to make it happen. I think anybody who works in an office or on a construction site might think that the efforts that they put into their job are as far removed from what goes into the making of a motion picture. It's actually much the same. Who causes a problem? Who's got an interesting idea? Who can make things happen a little faster than it happened? The end result is just different because you get a movie at the end of it.
If you were to take one thing away from the book, to me, again, it's this notion of you have no idea when you're going to accidentally capture magic or when something's going to go off the rails, no matter how well planned it might be. And there's a moment in the movie that we have coming up here, Casablanca, it's probably mostly true, involving the director, Michael Curtiz, and his star, Humphrey Bogart.
Yes.
And you include it in the book.
Right. I had read this story a million years ago, and even if it's not true, the shooting of the scene itself is.
Yes.
Literally, from are you ready, and rolling, and all of that.
Yeah, that's right. This undoubtedly happened. The reasons for it...
We don't know.
We don't know.
The
right.
Shot was this. Bogart, probably about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, back at a time when movies were done shooting at 5, meaning that everybody had a cocktail at 4:45.
Yeah,
you know, they call it a martini shot for a reason. It's because everybody is just finishing that first martini before the last shot. Bogey is in, he's at Warner Brothers. The lights are wicked hot. There's 8 million extras that are all dressed up in their finery, and they've been that way all day long. Let's call it the end of the day. They're going to need a shot. Okay, all the shot is, probably in the script, on a piece of paper somewhere, is Rick steps forward and nods off camera. Now, who's he nodding to? Why is he nodding? Is he nodding to Sam? Is he nodding to say, go ahead, let that person in. Go ahead, give that money back. Go ahead, let that lady order another drink. We don't know what he...
And Bogey, as the story goes, asks. And Curtiz is like, I don't know.
We'll use it at some point.
Right.
And Bogey knows how movies are made. It says, all right. And what happens? Are we rolling out? Bing, ling, ling. I says, ah, da, 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 da. And action, Bogart. Yeah. Hits the mark, looks off camera, nods, and then that's the shot. All right, that was gotten at some point. And in the end of the movie, it ends up being one of the greatest motion picture moments in the history of all of motion pictures, because Victor Laszlo has gone up to the band and he wants to drown out the Nazis singing some version of some Hitler Youth anthem by singing the Marseillaise, the French national anthem in Casablanca. And the band does not want to do it because they don't want to get in trouble from the Nazis, you know.
And they don't also want to do anything without the guy who signs the checks approval.
He's
their boss.
And so it's great because Victor Laszlo said, play the Marseillaise, play it. And the band looks over. I don't know if Bogey was even there that day.
Who
they
knows?
Just look over and then they start taking it. But interspersed in that is that scene of Bogart coming up, hitting a mark, giving a nod. Sometimes I just put that DVD on and scroll to that moment because I want to feel the hair on the back of my neck raise up as I then go around to everybody in the room singing the Marseillaise. Oh my God, is it a movie? And I'm going to guess that right after the shot, Bogey lit up a cigarette and says, so you're going to need me for the rest of the day, you know?
Right, and as we see, it's the moment in the movie where Bogart enters the fight, the nod.
That's right.
That's when he's
right after that. I am shocked to find that there is gambling going on here. Your winnings, you know,
it's everything. It's
Rick's is closed down, and the rest of the movie, you know, ends up going on from there.
Hard to imagine a movie getting the ending better. and they didn't know what it was going to be during most of the shoot.
I heard that they were trying to figure out a piece of dialogue that was going to seal the fate of Claude Rains and everybody, you know, everybody in the scene. And the story I heard was that some pair of the writers, you know, Howard Koch and somebody else, was driving down, and they're like, how are we going to do it? What could we possibly say? What is it? And they both said in tandem, round up the usual suspects, you know?
Right.
And there you have it. And that leads, of course, into voiceover, probably recorded, you know, weeks later, in a recording, you know, ADR stage, automated dialogue replacement, the looping stage. Thought after the fact, added to it.
Louis, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
I miss the end at motion pictures.
Yeah.
I miss that everything built up to those two words, because then, man, if they nailed the end of a motion picture, that's perfection, and they certainly did on Casablanca.
You know, the Academy Museum opened, 2 years ago, whenever it was. Like, it took this town 100 years to recognize that this stuff matters. Like, these movies matter. They matter to people. They're not, it's not a disposable art form. It does matter. And I'm struck by how long it took for everybody to take it seriously.
You know, you and I were talking a little bit before, and I must say, on the Ben Mankiewicz TV channel, TCM.
That's what I'm trying to get
it called. It should be the BMTV, don't you think so? Staff, crack staff, get that on it. Who's talking today? Oh, it's Ben, great. Movies are this one-on-one relationship. Movies are made for one person and one person only, and that's the person that is viewing them. And we all have our own memories that are connected to a specific film that, if we think about it, we can remember where we were, what theater we saw it in, or maybe what weekend it was when we happened to see them on TV. The first time I saw The Maltese Falcon was on a rainy Saturday afternoon on a houseboat in Alameda, which was right next to Oakland, California, and I saw it cut up. I saw it, you know, edited for, you know, the Channel 5 Saturday morning. They didn't even show, you know, Archer in Spade and Archer. They just cut all that stuff out.
Right.
So half of it, I didn't know what was going on. But I could remember the specifics of being on a cold, rainy day, finally seeing some aspects of The Maltese Falcon, right down to, you know, the old man stumbling in with a package, and that turns out to be the father of the director of the film. And all this stuff starts tying in. And it's a one-on-one relationship you have. It's like as personal as reading a book. It's just you and the story and the filmmakers really get out for you. That's why the cultural purchase of all of these movies, even the ones that, like Storm Warning, which I just saw recently on Ben Mankiewicz television show, ends up transporting you out of wherever you are at a certain time and place. But it's a solitary trip that you make.
When you gave Ray Harryhausen his honorary Oscar, you said wonderfully, you know, some people say Casablanca, some people say Citizen Kane, I say Jason and the Argonauts is the best movie ever made. Does that come from seeing it? Did you see it when you were 7?
I didn't see it in the movie theaters. By that time, I would have seen it on like the CBS Sunday Night Movie or something like
Cut
that.
Up. Commercials.
Cut up commercials, but are you gonna, excuse me, that sword fight with those skeletons? I still see, you know, the Valley of the Giants where Jason, you know, ends up turning the valve at the heel of some big bronze giant and all this sand and water comes out. I call it optical poptitude. If you're 8 years old and you're seeing that, by the way, on a black and white TV cut up for commercials with, 325 lines of scansion on it, so it's not the crispest picture in the world. But you could not convince me that between Jason and the Argonauts, or say, Bridge Over the River Kwai, broken up into two nights over the ABC Sunday night and Monday night movies, were not the perfect way to see those motion pictures. I would have fought you tooth and nail.
We got one more movie to talk about from 1938, Bette Davis in Jezebel. Tom, the making of another major motion picture masterpiece, your novel, I think the classic movie star, and there are many classic movie stars that TCM fans will be interested in the novel. I think Bette Davis' name comes up more than anybody else.
If you were going to, like, honestly measure it out, is who was the most movie star of all the movie stars that have been movie stars, I think Bette Davis is number one. She had this flinty sort of like personality and a very distinctive, imitatable cadence. The intimidative power is that a word? Intimidative
power. I
think
it is, yeah.
Of her eyes and her countenance is undeniable and impressive and, in fact, intimidating. Actually, I will tell you a story about Bette Davis. You ready for this?
I am ready.
Okay, here you go. Here you go. The very first time I found myself at the Academy Awards, they said, we want you to give away an animation Oscar with Bugs Bunny.
Oh, nice, sure.
And I said, all right, hey, if Bugs will put up with it, I will too. And then they must have spent 45 minutes explaining to me that Bugs will not actually be there. I said, guys, the audience will see Bugs, but you will not see Bugs. Yeah, I got it. Meaning he won't be there. I got it. They'll see him at home, but he won't be on stage. I said, I think I'm familiar with that much of the process. And we went to the governor's ball afterwards, and I found myself at this assigned table, you know. And lo and behold, if I'm not sitting at a table with Arlene Dahl, Arlene Dahl, ladies and
gentlemen. We had her on the TCM cruise one
year. She was, among other things, she was in Journey to the Center of the Earth with Pat Boone and James Mason. I can't believe I'm talking with Arlene Dahl. And lo and behold, someone places a very frail, very aged Bette Davis at our table. And she happens to sit in the seat where my wife, Rita, had just been occupied. So literally, I'm literally talking to Arlene Dahl. The next thing I know, Bette Davis is sitting right there where Rita just was. And I'm thinking, Rita's going to come back from the bathroom. And she's going to have to sit on the other side of Bette Davis. And I turned to Miss Dahl. I said, I don't know what to do here. Bette Davis just sat down in my girlfriend's seat. And Arlene Dahl said, oh, kick her out. Just kick her out. She'll love it. This is 1986, maybe, 86, 87. And I said to Bette Davis, Miss Davis! A lot of noise going on.
You have to introduce yourself? Does she know who you are?
No, she had no idea. And I said, Miss Davis, my name's Tom Hanks, and you are sitting in my girlfriend's seat. But if anybody can take the place of my girlfriend, it is you.
Nice.
And she said, what? And I said, my name's... Reintroduce myself. You are sitting in my girlfriend's seat, but if anyone can take her place, it is you. And she said to me then, I can't hear a word you're saying. Of course, didn't get to the Jezebel required. And this, to me, Jezebel is the preeminent Bette Davis performance. The sheer command of the screen that Bette Davis has in Jezebel, I think, is the epitome of a well-founded starring role in a motion picture. I don't think anybody has ever topped Bette Davis in Jezebel. She is beautiful, she is driven, and you have a preconceived notion of what she wants from every scene before the scene begins. It must have been some supernatural power that she had somehow in the choice of materials. You always find out about how she was ended up fighting with everybody who ever ran a studio, you know, with the brothers Warner, with whoever was making whatever it was.
And with her director, William Wyler, who she had a love affair with, but they fought constantly.
This was a lady who knew the type of art that she wanted to make. And also, I think she knew that only she could make it.
So did you go to a lot of movies as a kid?
I did not. I was not a massive movie-going guy. I didn't run off to the theater constantly. But I can tell you what movie I saw in what movie theater. I mean, I saw Duel at Diablo at the Alameda Theater. I saw Hard Day's Night at the Island Auto Movies. I saw 2001 A Space Odyssey at the Cinerama Domes, and I saw the re-release of 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea at the Golden Gate Theater in San Francisco.
Those are movies that made some sort of impact.
Yeah, didn't really get into films until the 70s, in which movie theaters were trying to make money by becoming repertory cinemas, in which they'd have a different bill every night, and the theater owners would put out a three-month. So, like, for example, I saw... when I was in college, I went and saw all of the James Dean movies in one night.
No, really. No,
One bill, or saw like Nicholas Rogue movies in one night, or you know, some sort of like Cocteau's, you know, Beauty and the Beast and Jewels and Gem on the same bill on a night. That's when I started getting into that.
Your story is about making a superhero movie from an obscure comic, but it's a process story. And you've said that the way to succeed in Hollywood is to solve more problems than you cause. Again, like, you don't have to be a movie star to live a life like that. That's in so many people's jobs.
There's a moment of supply and demand. You know, who can deliver the goods when we need them? Sometimes that person is number one or number two on the call sheet. There's other time of who's late, who is making it impossible for us to get what is necessary every day. And then there's also who is the secure person or the insecure person who shows up. Sometimes it's the same person. I have shown up on movie sets thinking, I think I got it today. And then I found out I wasn't even close to delivering what was necessary. And there's been other times I said, I am tired. I'm in a really lousy mood. I had a fight with everybody I love last night. And I have to be charming today. Right. And I don't want to. And it turns out it's the most charming you've ever been in your life because you're faking it somehow. That odd juxtaposition between what is real going on and what is fake happening and how you have to make the fake look real even though the real is fake, it ends up being this ongoing fascinating thing of I have to be on time and I have to do what I'm told.
Tom Hanks's novel, The Making of Another Major Motion Picture Masterpiece, available now. Tom, it's terrific. Thanks. And thanks for coming and talking to us. We've wanted to have you on TCM for a long time.
Oh, thanks. Great to be here. Honored to be here, really.